But my wife's father is 98 and still functions in Switzerland. I married to a Swiss lady. Anyway, welcome, my friend. Girl. Oh, so nice to see youngsters also with me. Hallelujah. So, beloved, Jaffa. We are in Jaffa. Let's start with the name Jaffa. What is Jaffa? Jaffa comes from the Hebrew Yafe. Can everybody hear me? Yafe, beauty. Okay? And it comes also from the name of one of Noah's three sons, Japhet, because it's not Japhet. Actually, whenever you transliterate the names, the Hebrew names, into English, you lose all the meaning. It's Japhet, comes from Yafe, same thing, okay? Yafe, beauty, okay? A beautiful place. Jaffa is becoming the main port of Israel, back then, land of Canaan, the main inlet, outlet of Israel. Okay, by the way, till the Jewish immigration came here, I mean, after the establishment of Israel, 1948, what do you think, where the Jews came from? I mean, from the sea, by ship, to where? Jaffa, okay? And even decades before, as I've told you, 1910, the city of Tel Aviv, that you saw near the restrooms, and you will see it again, was established by 60 families who left Jaffa, okay? The area that we are going to explore in the next 20, 25 minutes used to be, are you ready? Junkie area. Junkie, not just garbage. It was full of garbage. Alcoholists, you know, people with alcohol problem, yeah? Drunk people, those who push themselves, you know, with cocaine. It was terrible. It was like downtown, like the slums in Manhattan. Now you remember Giuliano, when he was mayor of Manhattan, he says enough is enough. Those of you who want my help to be, how do you say, rehabilitated, you're welcome, and we will help you. The others to the jail, cleansed, okay, the downtown, I mean it. The same happened with the mayor of Tel Aviv, Jaffa, in the 1960s. They cleared it up, they built it anew, okay? And now, actually, from junkyard, the junkyard, the back junkyard of Tel Aviv, it became one of the most wanted places in Israel. You want to buy a house here? Repair your 5-10 US million, especially if you have a view of the ocean. And each house, almost each house has, you know, it has different levels. And usually the first level is a art, you know, workshop. Many artists work live here, okay? So it's a very, very well-to-do, became very well-to-do, very desired place to live, okay? That new, renovated Jaffa. Now, the ones who designed Jaffa that we are going to stroll, they wanted intentionally to give a sense of a Middle Eastern, 17th century Middle Eastern town, which means bicycles have even problem to go through the narrow alleys that I will take you. Okay, and you will see the drainage system coming, you know, drainage for the rain, okay, in the middle. You will see hanged balconies. You will see why I call them hanged balconies soon, okay? The postman come and there is a little hole in your living room wall, outer wall, and he just dropped the, okay? So it's an old style. No cars can go there, of course, needless to say, okay? So it's a nice place to stroll and be reminded of the ancient Jaffa and what happened here, both in Old Testament time and in New Testament time, okay? So let's start our stroll. And guess what? The lighthouse is on the roof of the traditional Simon the Tanner house. Over here you can see that this door over there. This is Simon the Tanner. I say traditional. Remember I promised you? I will, when it's not really don't know, okay? So down there, I'm pointing, this is Simon the Tanner house. Come on, remind me, please, I forgot my Bible stories. What happened at Simon the Tanner house?
The dreams.
Huh?
The dreams.
Yeah, yeah. Say, say, don't be shy. Mr. Peter. Hi, Carol, sweet Carol, yeah, you said it, yeah. My friends, listen. Mr. Peter is dwelling after resurrecting Dorcas, we spoke about it, remember? As we came out of Lida, the airport area, if you still remember what I said a few hours ago. And it's okay, you're jet lagged, it's okay not to remember. Beloved, he comes here. And let's say this is the place, okay? By the way, very interesting lighthouse, because the port of Jaffa, today it's just a marine for well-to-do and the fishermen, you know, with their yachts and the fishing boats, it's on the other side, and the lighthouse still functioning there, that's why they're renovating, okay? But it's interesting, lighthouse on Simon the Tanner, why? Why, it's a coincidence? Not really. Because from here, starting the light to the nations to spread. What am I talking about? Mr. Peter, sorry. Mr. Be careful, I'm Israeli. I'm talking only with my hands. By the way, if you want to shut me up, you know, just tie my hands. An Israeli cannot talk with his hands, okay? Without his hands. Beloved Simon the Tanner, Mr. Peter, Simon Sifa is hungry. He is hungry. And the third time I'll repeat it, he is hungry. This is a big detail. Big short and detail of the story. While he's hungry and he is waiting on them to prepare his food, he goes on the roof, thank you. I got it. On the roof and he wants to pray. He prays, okay? Probably the mincha, who knows, yeah? Beloved, while he's praying, God places him into, puts him into half coma, or, you know, he's not, trance, yeah, trance may be better. Okay, guys? And what he sees, come on, help me, I forgot the details, help me.
She comes down.
Yeah, but there'll be more details.
Unclean animals.
Yes, but the sheet was tied in its corners. It's a message for the Gentiles, for the four corners of the earth. What's going to? You see what I mean? I teach you how to read your Bible for Hebraic, not Greek, God forbid. Okay? So every jot and tittle is. I mean, who cares? You could ask Luke, who wrote this, account. Look, stop with your blah, blah, blah. Who needs this insignificant detail? It was on four corners, like, come on. And that it went down and up with the unclean animals. How many times? Thank you. Did Peter eat? Did he slaughter and eat? I mean, he was commander, right? Yes. But he was in a trance. Guys, it has nothing to do with food. How do I know it? Because the Bible tells. Because in the very same chapter, we are now in Acts chapter 10. Same chapter, when he goes to the house of Cornelius, we are going to be in Caesarea tomorrow, first thing. Are you with me? Tomorrow we will continue this story. He says to them, you know it is unlawful for a Jew like me. By the way, it is 10 to 15 years, 15 years after Yeshua's ascension. Peter is not the impulsive man that he was before the crucifixion of Yeshua. You know, he is actually with James, with Jacob and Yohanan, John, are pillars of the faith in Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. Don't look down at Peter, he's always impulsive, he doesn't understand what God tries to tell him. Really? When he gets the first instruction, he says, God forbid, I never ate egg and bacon. Are you with me? It shows you that he never understood Yeshua to do away with the Leviticus 11 dietary laws. Are you with me? When I became a believer, Saint Dell's told me, okay, come on, they can eat with us, enjoy, come on. Don't you know Acts chapter 10? No, I was ignorant. But then I started to look as I should look and read. Beloved, it is all of, but God has showed me not to say on any men, not egg and bacon and shrimps, any men clean or unclean. Are you with me?
Yes.
So why does God show all this to him, you know, with unclean food? Because he's hungry. God will use his physical situation because the natural, in Hebraic thinking, the natural is always speaking and pointing to the spiritual. Are you with me? God will use a natural condition of hunger to speak through the hunger of Peter about Gentiles. Are you ready? Who are considered, are you ready now for the next one? Gentiles, don't be offended. Pause in the story. Once Yeshua goes in Lebanon of today. How do I know it? Abel tells me, yeah? Tzor, Tzidon, you know, Tyria. And suddenly a woman, a nuisance, Canaanite woman, remember her daughter is possessed? Son of David, help me, help me. And the disciples forgot their earbuds, their Bose noise canceling. Remember? It's written in the Bible, right? My friends, and they tell Yeshua, wow, can you do something about it? I mean, she's bugging us, yeah? Are you ready? It's not good to give the bread of the sons to the least of the dogs. Ooh! Ouch! As a Gentile, ouch! Excuse me? This sweet Jesus that I learned from Delilah by stories of my parents. Oh, sweet, always so sweet. Calling me Gentile. Little dog? Yep, because Yeshua was a Jew. And he expressed a Jewish look till today, Rabbi Scott. Some religious, heretic Jews look at Gentiles. By the way, make way for the others. Yeah, okay. Till today, Jews look at Gentiles, please listen, don't miss me, as unclean, any males like dogs. Are you with me? And this is the connection. Unclean animals, which are lowered down three times, is to tell Peter, that three dogs are knocking at the door. Who are the three dogs? Two servants and one soldier, all Gentiles who were sent by Mr. Cornelius. Are you with me? Isn't it interesting? Don't say on any men clean or unclean. There's nothing to do with egg and bacon or shrimps or whatever. Okay? Now the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking. Okay? Everything is okay for me. I'm free, yeah, Paul says, but not everything is beneficial, yeah? If I stumble, my brother, yeah, I shall not eat meat till ever. But it has nothing to do with Yeshua canceling his own law. Do you believe Yeshua is the Son of the living God? Do you believe Yeshua might have been on Mount Sinai? Of course. So it's his law. How can he break his own law? Actually, Yeshua is the word which became flesh. He is the Torah, if you wish. Okay, if he broke even single shot or tittle, he's not worthy to be our sacrifice. Because he needs to be without blame. Are you with me? So it is this vision, which was maybe on this roof, never had to do with food. Clear? Hallelujah. Let's continue.